Hi, it's Larry here, Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Thank you for downloading the show. It's great to be back. We're all in the studio. Here we are saying hello to Hello, E.
Hello.
Nice to see you again, as always.
Nice to see you.
Sitting, of course, next to you is Laura. Hello,
hello.
Laura. And then bringing up the rear, as always.
As always. Not running ahead, I'm bringing up the rear.
Exactly. Nice to see you guys. So it's been quite a week of gaming, hasn't it?
It has.
Yes.
I don't know what we usually jump right in with what we're playing, so I figure we'll go in, and as gentlemen, it would be all right if Laura goes first.
Absolutely. So, I know where she's going to start.
Yes.
Doing
yes.
Something I want to
talk about.
What
are you playing now?
So I am obsessed with Mini Metro.
Still?
Yes.
This is like, we talked about this a couple weeks ago.
We did, yes. And I still can't put it down.
Right.
You're welcome.
You know, thanks, E.
Yeah, so just to make sure, because I don't know if we talked about this, it went from E mentioning it on Twitter, and I was like, oh, that's interesting, over Christmas. Right,
yes,
with the Christmas break.
So.
I picked it up and couldn't put it down. Mm-hmm. And then the next show when we came in, I said, Laura, you got to play this. And she's like, what is it? And she downloaded it during the show.
I started playing
and
it.
And it was, have you played it?
I have not. I've seen you guys obsessed with it, but I have not played it.
You should give it a try.
It's amazing.
It is so smooth and just super addicting.
Yeah. It's all of those things.
So I just realized, I told you this earlier.
Yeah.
I just realized there are multiple levels on it.
Oh, yeah.
I've been playing
New York.
New York.
Right.
For weeks.
Is it New York
really?
That's the open, or is it London?
London.
London's the first level.
Yes.
London Metro.
And they have very different problems to solve, and you have to worry about bridges and
tunnels and all kinds of things. And I didn't realize there's more to the game, so I am super excited right now.
Wait a minute,
it's
there's
like,
more.
Hey.
Yeah. Good for you.
Super fun.
Are you playing any more? As always, Diablo?
I have been playing that. I think we talked a little bit about it in the last show.
Yeah.
Where there was Diablo 1 recreated in Diablo 3.
How is that? I haven't tried it.
It's good.
Okay.
It
brings
good.
Back the memories.
Yeah.
Does it?
Yeah, because they recreated the entire thing.
Oh.
They have a filter over the screen to make it look like it's old graphics. They rebuilt.
Still remember.
I have
my first encounter with the Butcher, right? That's
yes.
The first time when you're like, oh my goodness.
what do I get myself
terrifying.
Into?
Terrifying.
Because... And it's really fun to see the progression of Diablo from Diablo 1 to 2 and 3.
Now, you played them all.
It makes sense, yes.
Yeah.
Because in Diablo 1, you're just in a dungeon, and all of a sudden this huge red scary monster comes running after you and kills you.
Right.
Almost in the first hit.
Right.
And, of course, it's very different in 2 and 3, as they've learned.
Yeah.
Anyway.
It was a different time, I think. That was like the same XCOM time period where they held no qualms with just killing you.
Well, that's
just.
We've talked about this frequently on the show. That's back in the day when games were hard.
Yeah.
Remember when there was no, you couldn't go to the internet. Laura, this is dating ourselves a little bit, and you're excused. But you couldn't go to the internet. You basically had to either go down to the game computer store and hang out, right? And ask the guys or the girls or look at a magazine. So you just really didn't have this instant access to everything. There was just no.
Sorry, I was just having this conversation with a friend yesterday. We were talking about old Infocom games and how you used to get stuck for 2 or 3 weeks mm-hmm. on a puzzle.
Right.
And you would take the puzzle to school and
right.
talk about it with your friends.
Right, and get the graph paper out.
And try to find a solution. And there was nobody you could ask.
Right.
You couldn't.
Well, you could just ask your immediate, you could only work locally.
Right.
There was a great tweet the other day.
Yes.
I think it was David Willis who tweeted it. And he said, you know, back before the internet, you used to have to run down to the library and break the glass and sneak in and in order to find out who Alf's brother was.
Right, right.
And now we can just click it.
In seconds.
In seconds.
In seconds, the internet's at your fingertips.
That's pretty funny.
So you're playing Diablo.
Yeah, I was going to say that I do remember playing Diablo 2 on the dial-up modem. I think that's probably the first multiplayer
Mom,
game.
Mom, don't pick up the phone!
Yes.
You didn't have
my
a dedicated
gosh.
Line for that?
No.
Well, we did, eventually.
You did?
After yelling at, you know, all the family for disconnecting everything.
No, no.
It was the upstairs line.
No.
I had 3 lines.
Did
what?
You? All right, now wait.
There was my parents' line, there was my line for my modem, then there was the 3rd line for the BBS I was running.
So that's what I got to ask you a question, because, and Laura, I don't know if you had this, but I know that at least E and Steptoe, you guys, we kind of shared the same upbringing. We were on bulletin boards.
Yeah.
Did you have a name?
I don't want to say my name because it got co-opted by a certain movie franchise.
I see. So you can't really use
it. I was Morpheus for the longest time.
Oh, before the before
like in the mid 80s.
Right.
From Neil Gaiman's The Sandman.
Because I can always, how about you, E? Did you have one? Okay, you don't have to say it because
was it Buttercup? Because the look on his face.
Not.
look on his face is like, I really don't want to say
remember.
This.
Because I know that whenever I meet somebody that's of our age and we talk about that, that's always my first question. There's always that smile, the stop and the smile, because they haven't been asked to repeat that phrase in probably 20
and
or 30
they
years.
Maybe they wish they'd chosen better.
Right, right.
I remember them being different because, like, my FidoNet name was not the same as the name I used on my BBS.
That's true. My FidoNet name was different, too.
Right. Yeah. And my first, I have no recollection of what my first internet email address was.
Right.
It was a uoregon.edu address.
I do.
But
I do
it was, it had 6, 7, 8 bangs in it, and I have no idea what was at the end.
Bang, bang, bang.
Mine was a series of numbers because everything was done through a VAX system. At the local community college, and it was a series of numbers that are just meaningless now.
But do you still have it?
What a great question. I don't know.
Back you then
we
checked it.
Back then we didn't have the same password rules we have today, so I bet I could get into it.
That's right. It's still be available. Anyway, just because I always like to ask, and I haven't asked you that question, because I remember we had him on the show before, Jeff from NASA.
Right.
Yeah, Jeff Norris.
Right, Jeff Norris. Mm-hmm. I remember I was someplace with Jeff, and we were sitting next to each other, and we were talking, and I said, so what was yours? And he broke out in the biggest smile, and he told me, and I'm not going to repeat it, because it's...
He still uses it.
He's probably still uses it, but it was just, it's always something you can always, it's kind of like a secret handshake nowadays, right?
Yeah, it is.
Anyway, I'm sorry, Laura, we got completely distracted.
That was totally fine.
As we often do.
I'm playing Diablo.
You're playing Diablo?
Yep. I also, weirdly, jump back into World of Warcraft.
What?
Yes.
What?
Yes. Just wanted to give it a try over the weekend. I was like, hey, we haven't done this in a while. Let's try that.
You haven't done crack in a while.
Yeah. Was there a head wound involved?
No, no head wounds.
Seem to remember it was pretty good. I don't wonder why I gave it up.
Wow. What made you do that, I must ask?
I don't know. Just wanted to give it a try again.
Okay.
See what was new. See what was different.
Okay.
They, of course, continually update that game as well as
That's
Diablo.
True.
Yes, they do.
And it has been 12 years.
It's not the same game it used to be.
That's, no.
Yeah.
No game can, I think, right, in that environment. Like, if you really put a platform down.
Right.
And you may not think to yourself, oh, it'll be around in 12 years. But once it is, you're like, what do we do now?
And right.
To change it.
It's amazing how much Blizzard has evolved. Wow.
Oh, yes. 12 years of, like, all kinds of improvements. And it was pretty fun. I'm only level 10. Probably won't keep up with it, but
okay.
It's better now than when I tried it a couple years ago.
Yes.
I think it was the last time I tried it.
Was there something that drove you back to it, mm-hmm. if I may?
No. It was just an
just
idea,
a lot of time that you had available.
You knew you were going to get mocked for this one. Right?
I don't know. I was like, okay, that's.
I was debating whether or not I should bring it up.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
You know.
Anything else?
Okay. Then we move on from me now.
Yeah. We'll go. Steptoe, what about you? What are you playing?
I'm playing three games.
Right.
One, just briefly, is I went back to Skyrim on the Xbox S.
Right.
And turned on the mods.
Oh, so which one are you playing? So when you turn mods on.
I have 9.
Okay.
So I have. I have a weather one, I have a texture one, I have a bug fix one.
Can you send me the list and I'll include it in the show notes?
Yeah, absolutely. Basically, they're essentially the top 9 most stable and work best together. What I love about the mod menu is you can immediately see what's the most popular and read the star ratings and stuff.
Oh, right,
nice.
right.
So it's like the first 9, there's like realistic villagers where they move in patterns that are a little bit more randomized and their conversations as they're walking around are a little bit more realistic.
Right.
A lot less arrow to the knee. And it's gorgeous in 4K.
It is.
I mean, it's not native 4K. It's
upscaled,
but it's, oh my God, it's absolutely stunning.
And then do you have an HDR television?
I don't.
Okay.
So that's my next big thing is to get an HDR television. But I have a 4K TV and it's a big 65 inch too. It's great.
Sure.
And it's, so Skyrim's great. The mods are great. They're super easy to install.
Yep.
Two things. They turn off achievements. Just know that going
in. Yeah, of course.
They know that going in. I'm fine with that because I put 120 hours into Skyrim.
But to be clear, you can just pull up another save that doesn't have them enabled and you're back.
It won't pollute all your saves.
Right.
The second thing is watch your load order of your mods.
Mm-hmm.
Thankfully, most mods have a text file that says, don't load this before you load this or it will undo.
Steptoe's tips. There's a load
so
order.
Those two are good.
Much like life.
Go into config sys and auto exec.
No, not that bad.
Set my
it's not bad. But it did feel a little like that, though. It did feel a little like that.
I don't think I want to do that.
The second thing I've been playing, speaking of Blizzard, is I finally, you're going to laugh because it's been so popular, but I finally got into Overwatch.
All right.
Now, I saw you playing the other night. I was going to invite you, but to be honest with you,
Yeah.
You were only level 5.
Let me tell you the story. Let me tell you, because it's funny. I started playing, and I was playing against AI, and I got to where I liked a couple of heroes, and I felt
which
confident.
Which ones?
Bastion, mostly, but yeah. I sometimes...
He's a little OP. But he's a good starter.
Which is needed for me.
Okay, fair point. And what else?
So I started rolling with him, and then I dabbled in Mercy and a couple of the other
ones.
Mercy's and, really fun.
Yeah.
Isn't it, Larry?
What I ended up doing was rolling with Bastion, because it fits sort of my plant and tank out sort of thing
sure.
on certain maps.
Sure.
On other maps, you can't make it work unless you have the support people with you. So then me and a couple of friends got together and started playing the AI, and we were good.
Oh,
let me tell you something. We were good. We were so good.
Really?
That we decided that we decided we were going to play humans.
Yes.
And let me tell you, I'm pretty proud of us. I'm pretty proud of it. We got wrecked.
Yes, you did.
We got
wrecked. Well, how many people were there?
So we had full teams on both sides, but in our squad was 3. It was me, Josh, and Yesenia, and we ended up, we weren't doing terribly. It was just, you could see we were just so patterned.
Yeah.
And they would adjust to everything. Like it was beautiful, because the reason I'm proud of us is we actually had a great time.
Right. Well, that's the most important thing.
Like really watching these people beat us and seeing clearly how they were doing it. We just couldn't adapt fast enough. And they were obviously all communicating.
Right.
Because, I mean, they were instant pivots.
Yeah.
And then, so I'm having a huge amount of fun with that. I will get better at it. I still like Bastion. He's still...
Right.
I still basically like to plant the turret and just close everything down.
Yeah.
That's fun.
Isn't making all those R2-D2 like sounds.
Yeah, exactly. All the emotes and which I didn't think I would get into those either. But
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
We'll talk about that in the what I'm playing section
Have you run up against a really good Genji yet?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
And you're sitting there planted and he's in your back.
And then he's in your front. And then he's in your back. And then he's in your front.
And then the last game.
Yes.
Is Civ 6.
Oh boy. Okay.
Civ 6, which is more beautiful than it has any reason to be. Every Civ game has been a little cartoonish with touches of realism that were just perfect. This time it's like they went all out. Like I was sitting there at one point on the map and I caught myself just I was staring at the water. I was watching the sunrise over the water on one of the maps.
Right, right.
I must have wasted 60 seconds watching the sun reflect off the water.
That's okay.
I was just going, this is a beautiful game. Oh, I need to get these to get these soldiers moved.
Right.
So I've been playing a lot of that as well. I'm not yet in the just one more turn phase because I've been too busy with other stuff.
Right.
But I'm going to get there very quickly. That and I'm dabbling in XCOM too, but not very much. So I won't talk about that one just yet. But it's beautiful as well.
All right.
That's it.
What do you like? You just got back from a trip.
Yes.
We'll talk about, you want to talk about that now? You want to talk about it later?
Talk about it later.
Okay.
So I can echo Mini Metro.
Mm-hmm.
Both on... iOS, I've got it on my iPhone and my iPad, as well as on PC.
Right.
We were talking about this just before we started recording. It's actually, in my opinion, better on PC.
Mm-hmm.
And if you haven't tried it there and you really like Mini Metro, you should. As you get up into levels and you've got more and more lines running around, you wind up having to get into really dense areas and drag things around.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's kind of hard to grab
more precise,
the right thing.
Yes. Precise dragging, for lack of a better term.
Excuse me, I'm coughing because I'm just getting over a cold.
Right.
On PC with a mouse, you can get in there very precisely and grab this train or this line and move it exactly where you want.
Yeah.
And the extra level of precision is really nice.
Either way, it's a fun game.
Yeah, it's really
addictive. Because I started playing at my iPad. Played it on computer, and then Laura's just been playing on her phone, mm-hmm. so she hasn't really had that bit. But either way, it's addicting.
Have you noticed from phone to iPad, it's easier on the iPad because the screen's bigger?
Yeah, of course.
I don't need another game.
Yeah.
No, this it was on sale for 99 cents.
That's when I picked it up.
The great thing is it's simple.
Yeah.
It's an easy one for, I have a couple of minutes.
The music is kind of, it's procedural and it's relaxing.
Like the Minecraft music.
It's, yeah.
I yeah, love the that Minecraft. Or like some disaster piece stuff. It's, yeah, it's really nice.
Fun.
Great. So, now I got to get
so
it.
So you're playing that.
Ride the ferry.
Yes. It's perfect ferry game. I'm playing Civ 6 because Civ.
Because Civ.
I had switched to where I was just playing 5. I'm now just playing 6.
Yes.
They've changed a lot of things, a couple of which I'm still getting used to, like the biggest one being builders working differently now, instead of like you get a worker and they're just forever there doing things to your territory. You build a builder, and then they get three actions. And there are things you can do to let them have more actions, but I think of it so differently now because you can't just keep cranking them out because they're going to do their thing and go poof.
Yeah, that's what struck me as the odd part of the game was I think they introduced that in Civ Rev or Civ 4 where you just auto, maybe Civ 3. Where you just click and say, go do whatever needs to be done on this piece of land that is that is optimized for what I'm doing around that piece of land.
Right.
And you just let 20 of them go. And the next thing you know, turn 100, you've got irrigation, you got roads, you got railroad, you got everything you need. And this really struck me as, I think it's a good change. It forced me to pay a lot more attention to my management of my civilization.
Yes. And like, workers don't build roads anymore. Right. Traders build roads.
Yeah, so you guys have always been into Civ 6, Civ, and I've just, I appreciate it. It just never rang my bell for some reason. I don't know why. Yeah. Right, Laura? What about you?
Yeah, I think I've only played Civ Rev.
Right.
Civ Rev is the perfect distillation of all the things that people like about Civ. And then the main games, I think, added all the minutiae.
Right.
You can really dive into.
Right.
Civ Rev was actually, and Civ Rev 2, brilliant versions of Civilization. They were essentially Civilization 2.
Right.
And they were really, really well done. But yeah, it's a unique taste in a lot of ways. A lot like XCOM can be sometimes.
Yeah.
XCOM, to me, requires a lot more thought.
Yeah.
Like when I was laying on the couch yesterday, took the day off work, just homesick with the dog, and I was like, what am I going to do to pass the time? I can't sleep. Got my laptop on the couch and started looking for things to play and tried a bunch of different things. Eventually went to Civ because after 20 years of Civ, I can play Civ without thinking.
Mm-hmm.
I can't play XCOM 2 without thinking.
Yeah, they changed some things about it too, which I like. But it's still that very, like every moment, you're at macro level and then you zoom into the actual mission.
And die.
And every choice you make, every single choice you make could go horribly wrong or horribly right. And when it goes medium, that's the tense part.
Yep.
Like when it goes somewhere in between that, then you're like, oh man, I really needed that to go right. I'm glad it didn't go wrong, but now I'm super tense. Yeah.
So, all right. So you're playing Civ. What else you got?
And pretty much everything else I'm playing is VR.
Right. Oh, that's right. You've been doing a lot of VR lately.
Yeah. So
do you have the Sony? Have you played the Battlefront? Rogue One thing?
I do have the PSVR. I have not tried that.
I want that.
When did that come out?
The thing I want to do.
It's out.
Really?
Yeah. If you have a PS4 or a PS4 Pro and the VR kit, there's a, I think it's free. Don't quote me on that.
We're not the experts on
PlayStation.
There's
a Rogue One mission that is 100% X-Wing simulator.
Yeah.
It is. Go look at the YouTube video. Yeah. It's everything you could ever want in an X-Wing simulator. It's a mission that takes place after Rogue One?
We'll talk about
somewhere
Rogue One later.
Somewhere in the plot.
We'll talk about
that later. I do have a PSVR, I mostly play on PC.
Right.
Although I am looking forward to RE7 in VR on the PSVR. But I bought, or I built a new gaming PC.
That's right.
I bought an HTC Vive. And wow. The thing that has really hit me, I had tried seated VR before, like cockpit style stuff. And I was always like, oh, that's pretty cool. You know, I don't completely get the excitement, but this is fun. It's a neat gimmick. Playing like FPSs at room scale, where you've got lots of room to move and you can.
That's the key. You got to have that room.
And
you got to have a lot of room.
Yeah. So I've got.
So you returned upstairs in your house, right?
Right.
Yeah.
My son's old bedroom is now my VR room.
Right.
I've got about a 2.5 meter by 2.5 meter play space.
Okay.
So lots of room to duck and dodge and do all that kind of stuff. And that to me really makes it feel like you're in a different environment.
Why don't we have any animated GIFs of you running around with your headset on? I got to talk to your dog.
There's
you got to put a GoPro
probably
on
some. Yes. There were people over at Christmas who were filming and they probably were taking video, honestly. But there are some fantastic games.
Yeah, there's a lot of real neat experiences.
Yeah, my personal 2016 game of the year was Space Pirate Trainer,
right,
which is a $15 game. It requires a, you know, $2,000 PC and an $800 headset, but the game's only $15.
It is. Yeah, the price to the barrier to entry and the space.
Yes,
is a little bit steep, but once you get that in order,
yeah, it's too expensive and. most people don't have the space. It's not reasonable for the average person to do this. But if you're lucky enough to be able to,
yep,
it's amazing. So Space Pirate Trainer is the game when someone comes over, this is what I say. Hey, you have to try this to experience.
Have you been over to play Space Pirate Trainer?
I haven't had stepped
up. I have not either.
Who are these people you're inviting over?
In fairness, though, I'm across a large body of water.
You're far away. Right. I invited you over to play, and you bailed.
When was this? I don't remember this.
I don't remember.
All right.
Anyways, so think back to Star Wars.
Which one?
Think back Star to
Wars.
Star Wars.
There's only one Star Wars.
I'm always thinking about Star Wars.
Yeah. So the scene where Luke is going through lightsaber training, and there's the droid.
On top of in the Millennium Falcon, right? They're playing chess in the back, right?
Right. So it's a little like that. So what happens
with the blast shield down? I just want to make sure I understand. I want to set the scene.
So that's the visor part. You can't see anything.
Now that I've established the basics.
Yes.
So you are a space pirate in training. So you put the VR headset on.
Yes.
You're handed the two Vive controllers.
Yes.
And those are your pistols.
Yes.
And you're standing with your back to your ship. So it's a 180 degree game.
Mm-hmm.
And you are looking over a platform that drops off, and you have big open space in front of you.
Where does the pirate part come in?
There's a spaceship behind you. You're a space pirate in training.
Like, I look down? Do I have pirate boots on?
No.
To my left? Do I have a space parrot?
Yes.
Okay.
Now let it go. I knew if I didn't say yes, he'd keep asking. So
space pirate.
Arg. Wave one. One droid comes floating up.
Okay.
Nice round droid.
Yeah.
It's slow. It's dumb. It takes a long time to figure out
what you want to shoot.
You've got your two guns.
So they're guns. They're not lightsabers. Laser swords.
They're not lightsabers or laser swords. However, you can reach them behind your back like you were drawing an arrow from the quiver.
Yes.
And pull the trigger, and it converts into a shield. So you can have shield and pistol. Plus, there are also, while there's a default laser pistol shot, you have five other shots you can choose from.
Okay.
So there's something kind of like a shotgun blast. There's grenades. There's a couple different options. But you shoot this one droid. Okay, wave over. You got 100 points or whatever.
Wave over.
Wave two. This time it's three droids, and they're slightly smarter and faster than the last one. And this continues, and it's more and more, and they're getting smarter and smarter, and there's more kinds of droids. When they shoot at you, there's a very distinctive sound, and it goes into what is basically bullet time from the Matrix. And you can, everything slows down, so you've got room to either get your shield up or dodge, and this is room scale VR, so you can really dodge. So you can take two steps to the right, or you can duck under it.
How long are you playing?
I see myself as throwing myself across the room.
Is this one that you get weared out pretty quickly, or tell me about that?
I'll play for an hour at a time. Each individual game is usually 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay.
It's just so much fun, and it is the perfect distillation of what, like, if you had asked 10-year-old me in the 80s, you know, hey, you know,
that guy who was trying to figure out Zork.
Yes. You know, what would you want to be able to play? This is exactly what I would have designed.
Okay.
So it's great. I'm playing a ton of other VR games too. I've been, as they come out and people are like, oh, this is good, I'm just kind of buying them to try them. Arizona Sunshine is pretty new, and it's kind of a standard, Walking Dead zombie adventure. You're walking around. Raw Data is really good.
Good.
Yeah. Raw Data is a multiplayer room scale shooter. Justicar and I have been playing online together. And it's really cool to be able to, it's a wave-based kind of horde mode style game.
Yeah.
But you can see each other, and it's VR, so you see their in-game avatar. And you're defending yourself, and you look around, and hey, behind you! And it's really behind them, and they can turn around see it. And that kind of stuff is really, really neat. So I've been looking for all the co-op VR stuff I can find. And
I'll play co-op.
Really cool. Well, you have to get a PC and
I have one.
And a Vive.
I have one.
What?
I've had one. I've had one for about, 6 or 8 months.
This is news.
You guys should talk to each other more often.
I guess.
Well, let's talk about what I'm playing and then we'll talk about that. Okay. I'm sorry. Do you have anything else?
No. That's
okay. So I know that, you know, I'm going to offer this up because you guys dropped the ball.
What?
Well, I'm just letting you know. I mean, we're talking about the...
He didn't mean you. He said you guys.
Yeah, you guys. Because okay. We were talking about your PhytoNet handles. And the obvious question, well, what was mine? And the listeners are probably saying, why didn't you ask him?
Not interested.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Not super.
Honestly,
not,
didn't
I don't
care.
Really, yeah.
All right. So if you're listening to this podcast, you want to know, hit me up on Twitter and I will tell you.
Laura might want to know.
No, I don't think she does.
I'm curious
Laura
now.
Might want to know.
I'm curious.
Would you like to know?
I would like to know.
Laura, okay.
Please, will you tell us?
Riff Raff.
Really?
Do you know what movie it was from?
No.
Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Yep.
You know.
I immediately knew which Riff Raff it was.
I've seen it, but
okay, it's okay.
Oh, you
it's,
have seen it.
Okay,
yes, I okay. finally saw it.
Okay. Anyway, so that was a random thing. So what am I playing? I am playing Overwatch. The update is out this week. It's the Lunar New Year with the rooster. You got a great skin with Bastion with the rooster up here. It's,
oh, cool.
It's amazing.
Is it a space parrot?
There aren't
a space parrot.
A space parrot could be. That's the new game, Space Parrot. Playing Resident Evil 7, Biohazard, of course. That's a Play Anywhere game between Xbox One and PC.
Oh, that's right.
Right?
So that's Play Anywhere very game. Cool. How is it?
It's great. I mean, I'm not a big Resident Evil guy because it's just a little too slow for my style.
Yeah.
But so right, and the other reason is I'm actually involved with playing the Halo Wars 2 Blitz
right.
beta.
That came out.
So that came out. And then I finished up over the weekend the Witcher 3 story.
Finally finished.
Finally. After
how many hours? Did you look?
I think I'm over 4 days.
Oh.
And the problem was, is I started playing, when did I start playing? Like 3 weeks ago? Maybe a month ago?
Oh, yeah, maybe about a month ago.
Started over from
the no, 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 no. I picked it up again.
Oh, okay.
I had gotten to one of the areas and I felt like I was kind of, it turns out I was only in act two of three. and then I started playing it and that game is just so unbelievable with the side quests and
yes,
the rest of it.
Gets distracted.
Well, the problem is, especially in those, have either of you played it?
No.
Okay. Have you played it?
Just barely.
Okay. The side quest, like, I'm going to do the side quest, like 15 minutes. 2 hours later.
Right.
Right. It's just every
like Skyrim.
Every side quest is a rabbit hole that does not end.
Right.
So I'm playing that. And then, of course, like I said, Overwatch. We got to play some Overwatch stuff. So we're going to, once you
yeah.
go, because I think I'm
up to, I think I'm up to 11 now.
Okay. I think I'm 82.
Okay.
I have not played.
We need to.
It's probably been a month or two. Since
when did we play? Around Thanksgiving? Remember we played
Thanksgiving, Christmas. Something
yeah,
like
we
that.
Played. We had a good time. We had the full crowd mm-hmm. in, so we got. We need to do that.
I found that against these people that we were playing against, certain people who knew they were too low to really be effective were bullet sponges.
Yeah.
Like we would just serve as bullet
sponges. Well, the key is that we play, and we haven't really talked about this, is if we're playing like me and like Lith and I'll play,
yeah.
he's DPS and I'm just healing him.
Yeah.
And with Mercy, it's the OP combo.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
ridiculous.
I just, D.Va's ultimate is so much fun. Sometimes yeah. when you get, I have yet to get a Penta, but I've gotten a number of quad kills with it.
Yeah, I think I've gotten four.
Oh, it feels so, especially if you can like launch it up and over a
right.
wall. So they hear it,
but they don't know
they don't, they can't see it coming. Yeah. So they don't know where to run
Boom.
To. And all of a sudden it drops in and
Boom.
Explodes.
Overwatch. So that's what I'm playing. All right. So now we need to stop for a minute and tell you what's going on.
What?
So
what's going on?
So,
what's
going
on?
So, if you haven't figured it out, dear listeners, Steptoe and Ear back for this one night only.
It's a reunion show.
Special
yeah.
show, yeah. We you know, I'm sure you started listening to the show going, wait a minute, what is going on here?
So, did I download the wrong one?
Yeah, is this 2008?
No, they're talking about Overwatch.
What's going on? But no, it's I told Steptoe, I said, Steptoe, I want to have you on the show again. Then we had to have you on the show because the last time, you know, we hadn't had the show since you left company.
Right.
And now where are you now? You're over at...
The Pokemon Company International.
The Pokemon, so you're responsible for all those kids walking around with their phones stuffed in their faces.
Only partially.
So what do you do over there?
I'm the VP of technology.
So you're the responsible people walking around with the phone stuffed in their faces.
That
pretty much.
That's a partnership between us and Niantic.
Right.
The tech's Niantic.
Right.
So
you're keeping their servers on. So when it doesn't work, they can... Oh, wait a minute. When it doesn't work, they can tweet you.
It's their servers. Those are not my servers.
So anyway, so it's... And that's in Seattle here, right? You didn't move.
Bellevue, actually.
Bellevue, yeah. Which is right next to where we're located.
Yes. Very excited.
So I was trying to get... I said I wanted to get you back on the show when you... You know, after you got that cool job. And then I said, let's get Step to on. Now, Step, what are you working on? Let's talk about what you're working on.
I'm a senior security consultant at Leviathan Security Group.
What does that mean?
Also here in Seattle. And what we do is...
By the way, I'm sorry to cut you off, but
yeah,
when
sure.
you were saying that, in my mind, I'm seeing Steptoe in a suit and tie, aren't you?
No.
He's got this big title.
Hey,
No, and you're not.
I have Leviathan.
Yeah, no, no ties.
Is that great. I'm sorry, Vandalay Industries? Leviathan, that's okay.
Great. Yes. No, it's actually fantastic. It's a wonderful opportunity. What we do basically is we solve our problems. When people have a security issue or a security design, and it could be a game company, it could be an online service, it could be a social network, it could be something of that nature, and they need someone to come in and provide outside expertise on, hey, what are the things we should worry about?
Or yeah.
What are the things we're not seeing?
Yeah.
Or what are the technical things that we need to poke around and make sure that in our rush to grow, we haven't overlooked something? Mm-hmm. That's what Leviathan does, amongst many other things. And it's just a lot of fun. It's a great opportunity to get to work with a lot of different companies that do completely different things.
So you work a little bit in gaming and also out of gaming, is that right?
Yeah, exactly. I'm as each consultant has several clients that we work directly with. Some have few that they focus all their time with. Some have a lot that they provide advisory roles at. But it's wonderful. It's a really fun opportunity, and I'm super excited to be there.
He's secretly working at Weyland Yutani.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like.
Now him wearing that shirt
makes sense. Yep. Now it all makes sense. Lord. It was so that's kind of why you tuned in, and you're trying to figure out why are these people on the show. And Laura, so we're recording this in the evening because you guys have other jobs,
day jobs,
right?
Are there new listeners who don't know who we are?
Well, oh, man, there might be.
So I gotta tell you this funny story.
Who's this Steptoe guy?
There's this new guy that works in our marketing department that I was telling Laura about, who apparently knows Laura, went to school with Laura.
Oh, and supposedly.
I got to dig up his name.
Wait, supposedly.
Well, UT is a big school.
He didn't remember his name.
I don't remember his name because I just met him once.
Yeah, that's true. It's 50,000.
So I was talking, I saw him earlier today because it's obviously, I wasn't saying that, you know, I haven't talked on the internet until now that the show's up, that you guys are coming in. I said, hey, do you know who I'm going to have on the show tonight? I said, I got Steptoe. And he's like, oh my God, I've been listening to the show since just it was you and E. And then Steptoe joined and then Laura joined. So he knew all of, he was a big fanboy. It was great. But it was, it's great to have you guys back just for a little bit, and you're always welcome to come back on the show. And that's why I figured we'd do a special show this week. I did a show earlier this week when we released the latest system update. I don't know if you guys saw the news around that, we did. Mm-hmm. We had a huge system. Well, it wasn't everybody. It was just going to preview audience, or I think they call it insiders now. So yes. They made the change, one button to guide and some other cool stuff. I don't know if you guys have had a chance to look at that.
I have not, but one of my consoles is in Insiders.
Oh, good.
When I got rid of my regular Xbox Ones and went to Xbox One S, I forgot to rejoin. I need to rejoin.
Well, if you need that, I think we know who can get that.
I think
we know the people. But yeah, so I was like, you know, I did the show earlier this week, and then Jeff, who's not here.
Right.
Now, you've met Jeff, haven't you?
Of course I have.
Yes. Right. And of course,
there were a couple shows, I think, where he was in just before I left.
Right.
Well.
So
I've seen Jeff more recently than I've seen you.
Right. Yeah, that's a true story. So he's actually over in London right now doing some work. I think he went to Rare to play Sea of Thieves.
Oh my goodness. Oh, that's,
yes, he was doing that.
Yeah. So I realized he was out of town. You guys are available. That's why I wanted to get. So this is exactly what's going on.
It's funny. I wonder how we would be if we did this every week again, because there are one thing I'm noticing when I open the guide and I go to the store.
Yes.
There's just so much.
Yeah. There's a ridiculous.
And that's just on the Xbox, mm-hmm.
right?
It doesn't even count the peripheral stuff, all the indie games that are out there, all of the top releases, all of the smaller releases that are what we used to call, you know, the little arcade games.
Arcade games, right.
Are now full blown, 12 hour games.
Yes. Right.
With more gamer score.
With more gamers. And they're beautiful and they've got huge production value. And God, when you just mentioned 7Cs, I'm like, oh, that's another thing I'm probably not going to have time to play.
Yeah, to your point, there's a lot rolling out. And since, you know, you guys have moved on to incredible positions working in security and Pokemon. I'll just say Pokemon. Mm-hmm. Do you have a Pokemon in your office? Do you have any of that stuff in your office?
I have a lot of them.
When do I get this? The guy who has, like, when he plays Munchkin, he has, like, all the props.
Right.
And everything.
Well, because Bellevue's just like 15 minutes away from the Microsoft campus. I've been trying to come over for dinner or lunch, and we just haven't figured it out.
We almost did lunch a couple of weeks ago.
And then something happened.
Yeah, come do a tour.
I think I know some people over there, too.
In my office. You know at least a couple of people.
Yeah, right? I think I do know a couple of people. But you
might have hired a couple of people who used to work here.
And you actually just got back from one of my favorite places, Tokyo.
Yes.
Now, do you understand why? Because you've never been.
This was my second trip.
Oh, this was your second trip.
My first one was in November.
Okay, but you haven't been since we talk about it on the show. Now you understand why I love it.
Yeah, I had a great time. And then this trip got to make a stopover on the way back. I went direct Seattle to Narita going over, but came back via Seoul. And we stopped off for about 20 hours in Seoul. Met the president of Pokemon Korea.
Oh,
he took us out for Korean barbecue.
I saw your tweet on that. When in Korea,
Korean barbecue in Korea.
Enough said. That's like goodness. I'll only do karaoke. I'll only do that in Japan.
You shouldn't even do it there.
I disagree. Uh-huh. I can hold my own.
I'm sure you do.
Baby, sleep on it. Paradise by the Dashboard Lights is my song.
In that shirt, I kind of picture more of a Bobby Darin Beyond the Sea.
Beyond the Sea. Once more.
So Tokyo was great.
I love Tokyo.
Seoul was great. Amazingly,
I've never been to Seoul.
So my girlfriend had asked me to bring back some Korean beauty stuff because she, like a lot of women I know, orders that stuff online because
what's so different?
It has like all kinds of weird stuff in it.
Like what, glitter?
No, but like snail bee extract. And
what does it do?
I don't know.
Snail bee extract?
Seriously, there are all kinds
of do you know about this?
Do they squish them and then put them into and
don't know.
Put it on
this Asian cosmetic black market? What's going on here?
This is a bit that, like,
I know it is.
Female friends of mine are really into this stuff and they get face masks and creams and all kinds of things.
Yeah, I don't know.
So I had been asked to bring some stuff back. What I discovered when I got over there is in Korea, Pokemon has a licensing deal with one of the high-end makeup companies.
Uh-oh.
Oh, really?
And I've like Pikachu face masks and Squirtle hand cream.
Whoa.
And like Bulbasaur, this and that. And so I came back with a giant bag of Pokemon beauty product.
Did you
Pokemon?
Wait a minute.
Beauty products.
I must ask, did you walk down the men's aisle?
Yes.
I don't think there was a men's aisle.
Oh, come on. There was.
I don't think so.
Pikachu, the new scent.
So yes, it was thinking cologne.
That's disturbing. We do have some new animation, but that should no. He only says one thing. He says Pika.
I know.
Unless it's in Detective Pikachu, where he does speak. So
I opened a can of worms with that. I walked right.
You really did.
So you are the you are now the expert when it comes to licensed makeup.
Only Pokemon for Pokemon in Korea.
Right.
I am still learning many things about Pokemon.
Yes.
I do not know all 900 plus Pokemon.
Right.
I'm still learning many of the evolutions. I did just learn how to properly sex a Pikachu the other day.
I'm sorry, what?
It turns out there are male and female Pikachus, which I did not
know. So how to identify, or are they participating in the act of? What does that mean?
How to identify.
Okay.
They don't.
That's a whole nother.
There's no participating in the
that's
act.
That's another aisle in the Pokemon.
We are an E for
more so
brand.
In Japan.
So when Pikachu breed, there is an egg, and you take the egg to the... I'm blanking
professor?
On the name, the nest center or something like that, where it hatches. And but to tell a male from a female Pikachu, look at their tail. A male Pikachu's tail ends in a lightning bolt. A female Pikachu's tail ends in a heart.
All right.
I had no idea.
Okay,
so
that's
the more you know.
I've learned things.
Now the Richard Attenborough of Pokemon. Mm-hmm. Or David Attenborough. David Attenborough? Who's the...
He has an extraordinary moment.
Richard Attenborough's the director, David Attenborough.
So you're having a good time over there, are you?
I'm loving it over there. Yes.
Good. So now do you guys get to work together?
No.
Like, do you do security on Pokemon Steptoe?
Nope. And if I did, I mean, our
you
client
even talk
is confidential.
Yeah, of course you couldn't talk about it. So maybe he is, maybe he isn't. I don't know.
Who knows?
Although I did notice there was some... Korean cosmetics peeking out of your bag when you walked in. So. That may be something entirely different.
No,
I don't.
I would have tweeted about the barbecue for sure.
That's right.
But I do work just a couple of blocks away from Jack's.
Oh, you do?
Barbecue place. That's right.
I work in Soda, barbecue right place. By Jack's. And that is a dangerous place to work because you will eat Jack's all the time.
Yes. Let me tell you, when we were in Tokyo, every night was a dinner that was planned us and our hosts at our parent company. And some of the food was unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
Everything. I mean, we've done, simple stuff like ramen and katsu and Japanese curry, but like some of the fancy shabu shabu and other things, like that we did shabu shabu with beef and spider crab.
That was when you took that picture.
Amazing. Yes.
And someone was like, what is that? I'm like, I know what that's crab. That's amazing.
Just unbelievable. And I ate a few things that I wasn't sure I wanted to.
Were they still moving?
No.
That is a legitimate question when you're in Japan.
I did weird out my hosts a couple of times when I wouldn't eat octopus. And they were like, why not? Octopus is wonderful. And I would explain that I don't like to eat anything that's intelligent enough to use tools. That just feels weird. Octopus are very smart. And they're like, what are you talking about? And I would have
you
to pull up.
Octopus.
So did you pull up YouTube and show the octopuses
exactly
getting out of the aquariums?
That's yes.
And ruined
and the one,
octopus.
The one getting out of the mason jar by unscrewing the lid.
Yeah.
And see, octopus.
And 20,000
really
Leagues
smart.
Under the Sea.
Right. And at
with
the
Kirk
end of
Douglas.
It, right. I think I just convinced them I was weird.
Right.
But I didn't eat the octopus. I ate just about everything else. I had fugu. I ate a deep fried fish that had the head on it with the eyeball still
Ooh.
There and everything.
That's adventurous.
Well, good
that,
for you.
Yeah.
Well, welcome back.
Thank you.
You know, so you weren't here, Laura, because I think you stepped out for a moment. We were getting ready to record and step till you weren't in yet. Mm-hmm. My first question to you was I right about the Japanese toilet seats?
And they're very nice, except when they're turned up too high. When they're too warm, that's
to quote the great Yosemite Sam, that'll burn your biscuits.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but they are quite fancy.
They are quite fancy.
Mm-hmm. You'd think there'd be a safety, like there'd be a level you never wanted it above.
The weird, at least the part I thought was weird, was when I checked into the room for the first time and I walked in there and it's got a proximity sensor
and it
opens when you walk near
That's
it.
That's what mine does.
And I was not expecting that.
It's like, hey, let's go. You busy? Let's go. We're going to do this?
No time like now.
And then and what's funny is mine does that because it springs to life. And then when you don't do anything, it kind of, the top goes, it kind of is like, okay, I'll close the top.
Yes.
Okay. Not now.
It's got the little remote there with all the different buttons.
There's a remote. That's to me the funniest thing.
It's like a...
Everything you need is within... Your reaching arms distance, reach. Yes. Why would you need a remote?
There's a control panel on the wall next to you.
Haven't I tweeted photos of mine?
It's like you have. I'm
it's
sorry.
Like an L car's control panel.
Yeah. Yes. It's delightful.
Delightful.
It is delightful. There's certain things in life that you must enjoy, and a Japanese toilet seat is one of them.
I just wasn't expecting that there were overheating risks.
Honestly. I was not prepared.
I wish that Yelp must have been funny.
Ooh, how? You know you can turn down the heat in those, right?
Yeah, but you don't know that until you sit down.
Oh, yeah.
Then you discover it's
then
too
the damage
hot.
Is done.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what happened? Well,
he does,
doctor, you won't
lick the tip of the finger.
How?
Can water bounce on it?
The one in Korea was fine.
Did you go to, when you were in Japan, did you go to the Japanese, any of the Japanese spas?
No.
Oh,
I
boy.
I was working.
That was one of my most extraordinary experiences I've ever had. It was.
Really?
Yeah, because you walk in, it was a spa. Where was it? It was out near the Messe Center. Anyway, it was a spa and you walk in, it was the old kind, old schools, it's all male, and you get into the, you take a shower and you get into the tub and you sit in this really hot tub, Laura, with a washcloth on your head.
A cold one to cool
No,
down?
Just that's what you walk around if you want to be, you know, discreet.
You.
Yeah, and then you use it when you get in the shower. So that's really all you have is you just have what you came into this world with and a washcloth to go through the entire experience. And it was just the hot water and there's something to just unplugging and going in and just taking care of yourself.
No, the closest I got to that was, hey, I have 2 hours in between meetings. I haven't had ramen yet. Where can I get ramen?
Yeah, yeah. Oh yeah.
The ramen is, oh.
Did you go into any of your arcades?
There weren't any good ones near where I was.
Oh, in Roppongi, that's right, there's not.
Next trip, I'm going to go longer and go spend a day in Akihabara shopping.
Yeah. You know who you got to talk to is Albert. Because Albert knows all the good places.
Albert and Chris Kohler.
Yeah,
and,
all those
guys. A coworker of mine did go and pick me up something while he was over there.
So good.
But I haven't made it yet.
So good.
Third trip.
All right. Little Xbox news while we're cooking along here. First of all, I want to thank you guys again for coming in. It's always so fun
Thanks
to have you guys
invite.
In.
It is really fun.
It's staying late.
Have you guys back.
Games with Gold are out. We've got Lovers in a Dangerous Space Time.
Fantastic game.
For Xbox One. And then that'll be free until for the rest of the month. And then Now you've got Project Cars available until March 15th. And then on Xbox, Xbox 360 and Xbox One through backward compatibility, you had Monkey Island. Now you have Star Wars Force Unleashed.
Oh, very good.
Okay. Yeah. That's is Force Unleashed the one where you can bring down the destroyer?
Yeah, I believe
it
so.
It had that in the video. I don't remember if that was in the game.
Yeah. I think it was.
So
I seem to remember doing that.
All right. So. By the way, I feel like we should do it now.
Okay.
Can we talk about Rogue One, the spoiler cast?
Yes.
I mean,
I feel like
it's about to leave the theater.
It feels like we should, but I know Jeff wants to be a part of it, but he's not here, so let's go. Yeah. Okay, hold on a minute. I just want to put a marker here so I know where to put, so if people haven't seen it, so they can stop.
Spoiler Beep. Warning.
All right, so if you're listening now, this is, I'm warning, if you haven't seen Rogue One, we are going to talk a lot about it. There's going to be spoilers and stuff for the next probably 2 or 3 minutes. So you have been warned.
2 or 3 minutes?
We should just all talk at once. Like, just pick like 5 spoilers. Okay.
All right, so
it's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just had how many times have you seen it, E?
3?
Whoa.
Laura, you've seen it once. Well, it's funny. You had like tickets to 6 different shows at one point. I remember you were texting me when they went on sale. You bought them here. You bought them there. I bought them here.
I had to see them, you know, on opening weekend.
Right.
At least, or the first day.
Right.
And I wanted to make sure I had backups.
Yeah.
Because I have a preferred theater.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And then, because I saw it a few days before
it
opened.
Multiple times.
I saw it before it opened and then a couple times after it opened. So 3. How many times have you seen it?
3.
3.
And I saw it at my little...
That's right.
Theater in Kingston.
So let's be clear. Oh. You live in a different part. You live in this interesting. Can we talk about?
It's
funny.
It's kind of funny. I live 7 miles as the crow flies from downtown Seattle.
But it's across
the
Puget
water.
Sound. It's across Puget Sound.
So I have to take a 30-minute ferry to come over. And I live out in a completely rural area. I have got a couple acres of land and
internet.
The dogs love it. It's great. But there's the little town of Kingston is not very large, and so it's. Movie theater is a converted firehouse.
Right.
Now, the guy who did this.
I love the story.
This is absolutely fantastic. This is a great way to see a movie. So he redid it with a digital screen sound system, and it's only got like 100 seats. Mm-hmm. I believe it's called Firehouse Theater in Kingston. It's literally sometimes worth going over just to experience it because here's what they do. The first movie I saw there was The Martian.
Okay.
I thought, I'll test this place out.
Sure.
I already read the book.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I can always go see the movie somewhere else if I don't have a good experience. I sit in there. Not a bad seat in the house. There's even a little balcony.
Oh, fun.
Like there's like 5 seats up in a little balcony if you want. The previews are running, and then all of a sudden the previews stop, and the owner of the theater comes out.
Oh.
And he says,
what does he say?
Tonight you're going to be seeing The Martian. It's based off of a book based by Yuri, and it's got, or was it Keaton? No, it was the other guy. Sorry, I got the wrong author. But he came out and did an explanation. He said,
He sets it up. What?
He says, it's really great. The special effects are fantastic. I saw it last night. I'm really excited about it. I hope you enjoy it.
Does he do that for every screening?
On the other screen, he didn't tell you what's on the other screen because there's 2 screens. He says, on the other screen we're playing at that time, it was Pan.
Right.
Now, here's the cool part. He was like, it's good. It's not super great. I really wasn't super impressed with it. But
so he's editorializing?
Just to let you know. No, he's like, just to let parents know. It can get a little dark in certain places and stuff like that. But we'll keep that for another week. And then we've got some art house films coming in 2 weeks.
Wow.
And I hope you enjoy
it. This is your new favorite place.
And then he leaves and the movie comes on and it's just perfect. It's just, the sound is great. Everything was great. But the real kicker is that when I bought my ticket, I was standing, I ordered popcorn. So I bought my ticket, I ordered popcorn, it's taking forever. And I'm just kind of wandering around looking at the posters and wondering why it's taking forever. They put real butter on the popcorn. They melt real butter for you and put however much you want
not
on the
butter,
popcorn.
Not that yellow butter
not
flavoring.
Oil. They take a stick of butter.
Oh, wow. Oh,
and then they're like, they cook it over a little thing. And then they're like, how much do you want
Kingston.
On your... How much do you want on your popcorn?
And they layer it, right?
Yeah.
They put some
put
in butter
in. Yeah. Oh,
and
absolutely.
Oh, wow.
Sold. Small town living.
Yeah, there's something.
But that's where I saw Rogue One, and it was a great experience, and I thought it was amazing. I think one of the things I liked the most about it is the soundtrack I was really scared about.
Yeah.
Turned out to be fantastic.
Yeah, so I want to point something out is, Laura, you and I see each other each week. Mm-hmm. You and I text once in a while. I talk to Steptoe about 2 or 3 times a week.
Yeah.
Like, I'll call him, and I'll, because we've got a lot, we talk politics, we talk movies.
Yeah, well,
what's
usually.
A call?
Yeah, what's the phone
He's
call?
He's much more interesting on the phone than you are. You just don't like to talk. You don't like to talk on the phone.
Nine times out of ten, I can't. I'm multitasking.
Yeah, that's right. True, Laura. You are not a phone person.
I'm not a phone person.
Nope.
But Steptoe and I have. So anyway, so we talked a lot about. Hey, we should talk
about Rogue One.
The Rogue One. So that's kind of one of the reasons.
Yeah, it's well shot.
Yeah.
The cinematography is excellent.
Fantastic.
I love little touches like no Jedi, no real Force usage. There's implied Force usage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
the acting's fantastic. And the writing was great. I want to see the dark version. I want to see the version that Disney went back and said, too dark. Way too dark.
You saw the clip of Chewbacca slicing what's his name's.
Yeah.
No, that was Force Awakens. That was Force Awakens, but that's right.
Disney is definitely keeping a very tight control over when things go a little too
off the reservation.
Yes. Mature, I guess, for the fantasy that's Non-theme parky. Yeah. Yes.
For lack of a better term.
Yeah, and I think Star Wars, going back and watching, I just showed Rogue One to someone who'd never seen a Star Wars film.
Right.
Really?
Where did you find this person?
There are lots of them, actually.
Really?
I was surprised, too. But I took her to see it, and then we immediately marathoned the original trilogy right after that. And she was like, yeah, she's like, that's the way to do it, because, you know, A New Hope starts 20 minutes after
pretty much immediately
Rogue One. Right. And it's like an immediate continuation. And then the spots in between Empire and Return of the Jedi feel more weighty, because you feel like more time has passed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so yeah, it was a fascinating experience. But I love Rogue One. I love it.
You know, I remember when I saw it, I called you, because I saw it right before I did. And I didn't want to talk about it because I want to spoil it. And, you know, Laura, you and I talked about it. And of course, Ewe hadn't talked at all, because you don't like to talk on the phone. Right. But we,
I use it for texting all the time.
That texting thing you have in your pocket?
Uh-huh. It's also a mini Metro device.
Yeah, that's true.
That's AKA mini Metro device. Well done. But yeah, Laura, you enjoyed the film. I mean, we just loved everything about it. We liked the just everything about the film just felt right. You know, and you know Gary, one of the screenwriters, right?
Yep.
Gary,
he did the story,
right.
And I think portion of the screenplay,
right?
And it's funny, he and I had talked about this 2 years ago. I mean, and it was
so right before production.
Yeah. And one of his statements was kind of, he didn't want to give anything away. He said, but you know, what's always kind of, there are two things that kind of bothered him about A New Hope going into it was the crawl says the rebels have won their first battle.
Yeah.
What was that battle? It's never mentioned. And then the second piece that bothered him a little bit was when Vader says, there'll be no one to stop us this time.
Yeah.
He's like, there's got to be something there to that. And I think that's where the kernel of it started, which I find fascinating.
Well, I remember when I came out of it and you and I talked about this, Digital Tarkin.
Oh, Digital Tarkin. We did. No. We had a great discussion about this.
And what did you think of Digital Tarkin, Laura?
I was not a fan. I thought they did as good a job as they could have, but I'm not a fan of CG characters. Like, I'm not a fan of CG Leia.
It was the uncanny valley. It was too much. E, what did you think?
I agree with generally not being a fan of CG characters, but to me it mattered that Tarkin was in there.
Right.
He needed to be.
Yeah, I mean, once you realize what it was, and it wasn't as bad as, you know, unfortunately the Princess Leia shot at the end, which a lot of people didn't like.
I don't know how that slipped. Like, I don't know how they didn't, maybe they just couldn't fix it.
Yeah, but anyway, it was, that's the one part that was because I play so many video games like you guys do, we're used to digital characters.
Yeah.
And it was like, this something's about us wrong.
I think my brain just intentionally doesn't notice it. Like, if I really look for it, it's like, oh yeah, I can see what everyone's talking about. But as I'm enjoying the movie, none of it registers.
Well, I guess
just enjoying it, going with the flow.
Yeah. I guess knowing the fact that Peter Cushing's dead, that's like, I was like, wait, I actually, when it came on screen, I went, I actually gasped.
Yeah. Well, because you and I had this great discussion and you had this great point about they did a fantastic job until they kept doing it.
Right.
Yeah.
Less would have been more.
It lingered too long.
Right. Had they done the long shots or reflection in the mirror but there was all these close-ups of face
arguments.
That gave me all the chance to look up and down his face a million times going, this is not right.
Yeah.
So that was kind of where it unwound for me.
Okay.
So that's all. Anyway, Laura, do you have anything to add?
Yeah. So I thought this one was really good. I very much enjoyed it. I did notice it was a bit darker, and they took a different tact towards the, you know, the Rebel Alliance, where they're not all good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
And I don't know how I felt about that. I was like, what?
Yeah, you hadn't thought about that before.
It added a nice level of richness and reality to the universe.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's not, you know, 70s comic book black and white.
Right.
It's, there are shades of gray. Mm-hmm. Not everyone on the good side is going to be good. Mm-hmm. Not everyone on the bad side is going to be bad. It felt more real because of that to me.
But to Laura's point, I think something that I just considered right now was that maybe this was their only opportunity to really do that. Mm-hmm. And so here they knew from the original trilogy, the Rebel Alliance had been set up in a certain way. So maybe with Rogue One was their only chance to show the Rebel Alliance going, ooh, we don't want to be the Empire. Mm-hmm. And then maybe that's why they pivot a little bit more in the next three films.
Right.
Granted, it's sort of retconning, mm-hmm. but I think, yeah, that really surprised me.
It surprised me.
Yeah.
I don't think
it's a good or bad thing, but yeah, it's definitely noticeable.
Yeah,
it's stark.
And I didn't think the guy at the beginning that kills the guy that's supposed to be his friend be the hero. I was like, what? It's a very different take on a Star Wars universe.
And yeah.
I thought that was an interesting and refreshing way to do it, but it was a bit darker.
Yeah, and I love Mads Mikkelsen. I mean, I've been a fan of him since Casino Royale, right? I mean, who couldn't be? And I was like, wait a minute, he's always a bad guy. Well, he wasn't really a bad guy this time, but he was. Right, they kind of gave him that excuse mm-hmm. to be evil, but not be evil. If that makes any sense, right? Because he was trying to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it was.
The other thing I took away from it is, it's a tragedy. The movie is the definition of a tragedy. Everybody dies at the end.
It occurred to me when I took the person who hadn't seen any of the Star Wars films. It occurred to me, like right at the end, like a few seconds before all the things happen.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Oh. Yeah, she's not gonna know. I know, of course.
See her anymore. Like, yeah,
all these people have to die. They have to because none of them show up anywhere else.
Right. Yeah. The only other problem I had with it was in you and I talked about this was the end of the film where the
Bader.
Right. Well, first of all, Bader was a complete
beast mode. Was pretty.
Yeah,
cool.
He was unbelievable. Was great. That was that was another where I was my jaw was on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that he clearly knows the plans are on this ship. So this, you and I talked about this, right? And that was kind of, I don't want to say a plot hole, but that area sagged in terms of logic.
Did you watch, like, after you watched Rogue One, did you go back and watch Star Wars?
No, I didn't, but I watched your tweets.
So one of the things I thought was interesting was going back and immediately watching A New Hope a couple days later was like, all of Vader's stuff sounds very sarcastic.
Right.
And it kind of works.
Yeah.
Because he's like, I know you're not a diplomatic ship. And before it was like, you thought it was a suspicion, but now you know he knows.
Yes,
and
right,
he just kills that guy and throws him to the ground.
Right.
And I took it like that when I got a chance to watch A New Hope. I did agree at the end that was weird.
Yeah.
That was an odd choice. They didn't have
Can you talk to Gary about that, please?
Sure.
Okay. Anyway, it was a lot of fun there. And of course, we have another Star Wars film coming up this year.
Yes.
I don't know how I feel about this yearly thing.
The Last Jedi.
More importantly for Steptoe, we have the sequel to Prometheus coming up.
Yeah. did you know that I went? Did you guys know? I don't know. I know Laura did because we talked about it on the show. I don't know if you guys know this. I went to New York to do the movie, the junket for the Assassin's Creed movie.
Oh, right.
Yes.
I did know that.
I missed a screening of that by a couple of hours. I was really kind of ticked.
And it was great to talk to, the stars.
Oh, sure.
I mean,
yeah.
I don't want to tell the story again because the listeners have heard it, but just about the run-in. I don't want to say run-in. What would I say that I had with some of the cast members were very nice.
Mm-hmm.
And Jeremy Irons was just a delight.
Yes.
He complimented me on my voice.
He paid you the biggest compliment.
And I was like,
Jeremy Irons complimenting you on your.
Yeah, it was a oh my god moment. But it was anyway. It was just a lot of fun to talk about Prometheus with
Michael Fassbender.
With Michael. Although he didn't.
Oh, it's Michael to you.
Yeah, he didn't want to talk too much about it because he was there to promote the other movie. And I was.
He's Mr. Fassbender to me.
He was very nice. We had a great conversation.
Oh no, I imagine he's always seemed very very approachable.
Yeah.
And to be honest, he's one of the best parts of the film.
Right.
My problems with it are mostly story.
Right.
It's not really the movie's gorgeous.
He plays a big role in Alien Covenant, apparently. So I'm very excited.
Wouldn't surprise me.
Anyway, that's the end of the movie section. Actually, hold on a minute. Anyway, so that's kind of the end of the spoiler part. Jeff is going to be upset that he couldn't.
I'd like to hear what he covered in the next show with him. I'd like to hear.
So the bad news is, we're out of time because I know Steptoe, you have to go somewhere. You've got to get home to your dog. Laura's got a life that she has to get onto, and as do I. But
wait, why do you and Laura get to have lives?
Well, I'm just saying. What I'm just saying is, you have previous engagements. We've got stuff that we have life. Like we have life.
Mine is I'm going to get to play with a friend's chinchilla.
Cool.
When you have the opportunity to play with a chinchilla, you should take it.
They're really soft.
I hear.
They're very, very.
And then
soft.
Of course I got to get across the water to get back to the dogs, so they don't sit at home all day.
Why don't you give them some movies and some money to send them to the movies? I'm just, this guy sounds like he'll watch them.
A movie plus doggy daycare.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I want to thank you guys for coming in. I know it was especially for you, Steph.
It was well worth it.
It was a schlep. I'll have you on again. Can you come on again? Absolutely. Well, maybe we'll do even longer.
Any time for even longer.
Sure. You know, we talked about doing this. You know, I've got this device that I talked about off the air that I did a Facebook live stream with that went horrifically wrong.
It looks like an Amazon Echo with an eyeball.
It does.
The Mevo. But I maybe we can do a Facebook live stream. That'd be fun. Google Hangouts, we used to do those all the time. But I want to have you guys back on again. I really appreciate you guys coming in.
We need to play some co-op. Let's go do some horror.
We can do Overwatch. I'll show you guys how to do a little E and I play that and stepped up Laura.
I still have some leveling up to Laura. Do as well.
Probably not as bad as me. I'm pretty low.
You know what, Laura? You can be the healer. Okay,
I was an Overwatcher, pretty cool. I made Mercy for a while.
They are legit. Mm-hmm. You've seen some of my play of the games, right?
Oh yes.
Yeah. So I mean, so we should do that. But I want to thank you for coming over the water, E from joining us, and I want to congratulate you guys on these awesome gigs that you have.
Thank you.
How do they find you on Twitter, Steptoe?
Steptoe. STEPTO.
And then Laura, they find you?
At Laura Lollipop.
Yeah, I'll put a link in the show notes. Of course, you can find at The Vowel.
That's correct.
In fact, it's pretty strong. We were talking about you a couple weeks ago about how you remember when he was resisting on Twitter? You thought it was the stupidest thing ever?
Oh, yeah. 2008.
That was 10 years ago.
He would come in and like flip the table. He's like, it's the stupidest thing ever. So anyway, that's how you find it.
I still think it is, but find me there.
Anyway, so we'll talk to you guys next time, and hit these guys up on Twitter. Thanks for listening, and we'll be back next week with Name the Game, Laura.
That's right.
Jeff will be back next week, and we'll have some other cool stuff, and we'll talk to you guys next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.